Welcome to the Scandinavian Herland Report, Lillian Müller. You are quite a beauty queen and with a spectacular career behind you. You have been on the cover as a cover girl for Playboy 8 times and 40 times in total in the world. And you are also an accomplished author, a best-selling author, and a renowned actor in Hollywood, and also you've participated in so many exciting things in your life. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
About my exciting Cinderella life. In a way, you know, to the world it has been quite exciting, and it has been a little bit of the Cinderella story, considering I came from what they say nothing, you know, middle of nowhere on the farm in Norway right after Second World War, where everybody was poor and struggling. But I was a little bit of an unusual child, because I had faith in God from the very beginning, and I used to go to Sunday school every Sunday, and there was always an interesting grown-up that was telling stories from the Bible, you know, the Old Testament, and then later on the New Testament. And so I grew up with a very strong faith in God, and even going through many demanding things as a child, I grew up thinking that, oh my God, one day when I grow up, I'm going to be somebody, you know. And I always thought I could do it, you know. I always thought that, oh, well, I will be able to, because God is with me. And I felt from the very beginning that I had a special mission and a purpose in life, and I had a lot of faith in life and in the universe and in God. So when I set out on my mission or on my journey, it was just like, you know, people say, oh, you did this and you did that and you struggled with this. And then, no, for me, when I look back at the thread of my life, it's like it just one little thing led to another, led to another, led to a person came into my life, something happened, you know, an event or whatever. And in the end, now I'm 66 years old and I'm sitting here and I feel I'm on the top of my life. Life is so beautiful and I can't wait to see what's around the next corner. Very interesting how it can be.
Yes, it really is. And your career really was spectacular. I believe also you were in the middle of an education at the time when you first started out as a model in London, I believe.
Yes. First of all, I was a Miss Runner Norway, Miss Norway runner-up when I was around 21. And that's kind of how it started, you know, because I went to Oslo and I was in this Miss contest and I met all these other Miss Norway contestants, and it was like, you know, fun and exciting and a little glamorous, whatever, and I got a little taste of it. And then my mom sent my picture into another contest here in Scandinavia called Miss Beauty International, which was based out of England. And like, I became number two in Miss Norway contest, I also became Miss Two in Miss Beauty International. I was number two with some cute brunettes that won in both contests. And I was this tall blonde. You know something, at that time, I think I wasn't arrogant, but I think that I came off arrogant. People read me as arrogant because I was so shy and so insecure. And so I felt so insignificant, like I was a little dot on the map, you know, for people. And you know, that tend to make people look sometimes, and especially if they're good looking, that they can be arrogant. So, you know, don't judge a book by its cover, because sometimes that's really false. People are just shy and clumsy and everything. Yeah, so I got a little taste of it. And then when I went to teacher school in Kristiansand, to teacher's college, I finished my education about halfway there. And then I met a very cute, very sexy, handsome soldier from England who took me out to foreign countries. And I ended up in London at London Academy of Modeling when I was like 23 years old. And before I knew it, I had a career in London. And the London Sun, I was like, my first record was like, you know, the page three girl in the London Sun. I think I was there like five times before Playboy saw me and invited me to come to America and be a centerfold. And then I became Playmate of the Year. And then it really started my career.
And I believe also you've done a few very famous music videos as well, participated in these.
Well, I was in I was with Rod Stewart in If You Think I'm Sexy. Not that I can sing, that's not one of my things in life. But you know the song, If You Think I'm Sexy, with Rod Stewart, really great guy, by the way. I also did a whiskey commercial for Scotch whiskey for Japan with him. So I worked with him twice. He's a really cool guy, Rod Stewart. fantastic gentleman. Not what you read or what you think, reputation or whatever. To me, it was super fantastic. And then I was in a Van Halen video, Hot for Teacher. And then I did, like, you know, Magnum P.I. with Tom Selleck. And I did shows with a lot of actors. I starred in two films in Germany, and I starred in co-starred with Tony Curtis in Casanova in Italy. And I did a lot, like 25 episodic guest starring and co-starring in American television these years.
And then you wrote a book, but I believe you started writing when you were like 40. Was that a time when you started to think? You know, at one point we end up realizing.
It was like my daughter. I became pregnant when I was like 38. And okay. I was not going to have a baby, but, you know, I ended up having my daughter. It's the greatest thing that ever happened to me, hands down, can't compare to anything else. Phenomenal, heavenly experience, you know, pure sacred in my life. But before then, when I was pregnant, I couldn't work as a model or actress or whatever. So I her father said to me, Lillian, you know so much about health. Why the hell don't you sit down and write a book? And I go, me, write a book? Are you crazy? I don't know how to write a book. Are you kidding? I couldn't even typewrite. I wrote everything by pencil, in pencil and paper. It took me a year to write this book. You know what I mean? I would hide myself in the bedroom with a big bowl of air-popped organic popcorn every day with no oil or whatever. And I was so nervous all day long. I was just like eating popcorn and writing a little and then asking my daughter's father, you know, how should I start this chapter and that chapter, you know, and he was always guiding me along and helping me get started and everything. But he said, just write your book like you write all these 20-page letters to your mother and grandmother in Norway about what's happening. That's how I started, did my book. Like,
really?
I was writing to my grandmother or my mother, like, about carrot juice or, you know, why you should eat green things, why you should detox your body, why you should think positive. I mean, all the things that you write in a health book, you know, it was always like, oh, I was thinking of my grandmother. How would I explain this to my grandmother? And how would I explain that to my mother? And that's how I wrote my book.
And that became a big bestseller in the
still
U.S.
Still selling.
Yeah.
I mean, if you go on Amazon, Feel Great, Be Beautiful, over 40, it's still selling. And you get secondhand copies everywhere, you know. Changed my whole life, though, because it took me out of the Playboy category. Not that there was something wrong to be this big Playboy queen in the world. That was gave me a lot. It opened many doors, got me into America. I became Hugh Hefner's girlfriend. I met a lot of interesting, super interesting, famous people through Playboy and everything. But, you know, it was a stepping stone for me to get into the health and fitness beauty world, the natural health world. So with the book, that gave me an introduction to go out and be a public speaker.
And then, but still, yes. I would say that there's something remarkable about you. You come across as such a person. You've done what you wanted to do in life. And I think that's what
I'm half there.
Yes, but many people don't do that. They end up not, you know, being restrained and living a restrained life, thinking about, do others think about me? I have to all the time do whatever is the politically correct. I have to make sure that everyone likes
me. Can't live that way.
I think sometimes that those people will end up, when they're 70 and 80, having a lot
frustrated.
Of regrets because they never even lived life to the fullest.
You have to follow your heart. I remember I had a biography published in Norway, actually, that I forgot about. In 1998, called Usminket, which means in English, without a trace of makeup. And when I was on a book tour, the publisher gave me a book that I was just being selling in Norway, became a big bestseller, The Alchemist.
Yes.
Paulo Coelho,
yes.
The Alchemist. And I remember I read that book on my book tour. And I thought to myself when I read that book, that's so much like me. You know how you go... You're after something in life. You don't know what you're searching for, but you have this drive that's driving you. You've got to go on. You've got to move on. You can't relax in the comfort zone, you know. You've got to just keep on going and following your dream and look for signs, and then you will get there, you know. You have to have the faith that you will get there. And I think that with me, I have done one thing right. I have kept my eye on the ball. You know that thing? Keep your eye on the ball. Don't look left too much. Don't look right too much. You've got to keep your eye on the ball. No matter how dangerous and scary and frightening and intimidating and everything is, just, and you might fall by the wayside, by the way. It's like you're going on the ladder, you know? You go so far and then bang, you fall down five steps. But, you know, strong people or winners in life, I think actually that's the difference between loser and a winner. We're all pretty much equipped with great talent and possibilities and everything. But, you know, when times get hard and life gets hard, we have a tendency to fall. But the winners, you see, they have this innate drive and passion in a way, you know, and faith or whatever it is, that just kind of gets you back up there. You just strive to get back up there. It reminds me of a little tiny grass when you go in New York or something on the cement in the summer, and it's a gray and cement and it's steaming hot and everything. And all of a sudden you look down and there's this little tiny grass that's coming out of the asphalt or the, you know, cement or whatever, right, where you're walking. And you see it struggling, you know, but it finds a little hole in the asphalt and it sees light, it sees the sun, you know, and then the sun takes it, or God takes it up, you know, and it became become a flower or a bush or whatever, you know. I feel like I am like that in my life, you know. I go down real hard, like I've had anxiety periods and depression periods in my life, and I couldn't even take a shower, I couldn't work out. I was not functioning, two periods in my life. I was really down, and I could have stayed there. And somehow, and people said to me, Lillian, you've got to go to the doctor. You got to get Valium or some kind of nervous pill or something to calm you down so you can function and work and make money, because I got so broke because I wasn't an actor anymore. I couldn't work. I couldn't function. So I went down, and then somehow I remember my childhood when I had so much faith in God in Sunday school, and I was going to go out in the world and become somebody and make something out of my life, you know. And I remember, and I thought to myself, I'm going to do it again, no matter how hard it is right now. I'm going to find a way, and I'm going to go, I'm going to get back up there somehow. And I think the fact when you believe that, and somehow you are given gifts or more drive or whatever, or you meet somebody you can talk to or something, and somehow you just like, you know, you are like this little piece of grass in the cement, and you just like manage, you know, and then all of a sudden, wow, you get up there again, you can breathe again, anxiety goes away, depression goes away. Wow, I made it. I did it again. I did it. Mm. And then you start again on your road. Mm. Because I think about life, you know, you are like, it's endless. It's going to be problems. We cannot stop it. But it's how we deal with the problems and the hard times and the depressions or the cancer or the heart disease or diabetes or whatever goes on in your life. It's how you deal with it. Mm. It's how you come out on the other side. Are you going to go down with it, or are you going to come out on the other side smelling like a rose? Yeah. And that makes life art. That's why I'm here.
I've read what you've said too about the time when you approached 50 years old and how you came to realize that life is a journey, obviously with these ups and downs like you're explaining, but that life actually, we're all facing our own death. And at one point in
life, from the beginning,
you realize this, and then maybe your values or the way you look at a life changes too.
Yes, it changes.
In what manner did you change?
Well, I remember I had this, my latest relationship. That was 13 years. I was with a fantastic, big, famous photographer in the world, and one day we had made love, I remember, and I was lying on the bed, and I had this book by Wayne Dyer, Wisdom for the Ages. And I am the kind of person, I like to start a book at the end and then read towards the front. I don't know how I started that stupid habit. It's probably idiotic habit. But that's how I like to do it a lot. And I was I was lying there relaxed, and I was looking at this book, and I'm thinking, oh my God, I don't know if I can read through such an intellectual book today. But I had a drive towards this book. I love Wayne Dyer, by the way. What a loss that was to the world. 2 years ago, he passed on, right? But he's gone to the next dimension, and I'm sure he's looking after us here and helping guide us or whatever. But anyway, that day I'm reading the book, and then I just thought, I'm going to just open the book today and see what comes to me. Because many times in my spiritual books and my metaphysical, psychological books, I will open at certain passages in the book, and it's exactly what I need for the day. I'm inspired right away to get out of my depression or my anxiety or my lack of faith or being intimidated by this difficult world sometimes or whatever, and I can move on, dust myself off and try again, you know, as people, as we all have to do. And I looked at that sentence and it says, I do not want to die with the music still in me. Mm. And I thought, what the hell is that? I don't want to die with the music still in me. And I thought, if I died today, how would I feel about my passing? Would I be ready to go? And I thought, Hell no! I'm not ready to leave this earth. What, I mean, we don't have any guarantee. Look at what happens in the world. It's a crazy world. You can pass at any time, right? So I thought, I have not finished my mission. I better get my stuff together and get myself together and go out in life again. It is not enough to be this big Playboy queen with 8 covers for Playboy magazine and 40 international. What the hell I've got going out there? And to be an actress and rock music videos with Van Halen and Rod Stewart. No, it's more. I have more to give. I have more to offer. I need to get my guts up to go out in the world and be my who I am, really. Who I never really was. See, today I am who I am. Now I have the guts to just be myself. But at that time, it was always, you know, even up to 50, oh, I got to look like this, and I got to act like this, and I got to talk like that, and oh, I'm going to be rejected, or I'm not going to get a job, or I'm not going to get the movie or the TV thing, or nobody's going to want me, and no man is going to want me, and my boyfriend is going to dump me, or whatever. So I thought I had to act a certain way, or look a certain way, or whatever, you know, please the world in a way. And I thought, no, God has given me serious stuff to do. I feel I have so much more to do. I got to get out again in the world, and I got to kind of start again. And I got to, like, you know, I got to just become a big published speaker or something. But anyway, I got to write books. I got to do TV shows or something. But I got to do it on a higher, bigger scale, and I got to do it in a more serious way. And my job in life is not looking good and looking sexy and turning on guys and making women jealous or whatever I did when I was young, you know. My gift is to be able to inspire. I discovered when I did public speaking that I could inspire people because people were sitting like this to me. And I thought, damn, I can inspire people. That's interesting. And then that started turning me on.
And one of the things...
So interesting.
Yes, and one of the things
that... I discovered
that,
new talent after 50.
Mm-hmm, that one of the things that really is a pity in the Western culture today is that we have become so materialistic. I mean, to be rich and famous is the only value. We don't speak about moral standards anymore. We don't speak about values. And it's a really a very egoistic kind of lifestyle. Let's say I'll keep you as my friend so long as it benefits me,
yes,
that you can benefit me. You know, I'll keep my boyfriend or my husband. I would like to have a rich husband because then he can give me. So girls actually go after the guys that they know have a lot of money, for example. So and I mean, the friends I pick, the stuff I do, so that everything can please me. And
yeah,
this is partly really the new age system too, you see. It's about my meditation so that I can feel better, so that I can succeed. And even a number of the Christian groups in the US and even here in Europe, this is one of the reasons I think why there's so little spirituality in some of the Christian groups, because they've joined the postmodernism,
mm-hmm,
that is, and the egocentric kind of lifestyle. God, please bless me so that I can be blessed and I can be rich and I can be blessed.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe my family, but then again, thank you, because I need you to bless me. So it's this ego-driven system. And in all of this, I do find that we need, you know, to really become accomplished and happy in,
yes,
life. You cannot only have outer values. It cannot only be the outer beauty that is the big thing. We have to think about the inner beauty. And the inner beauty is all about me loving one another.
Absolutely.
To love, really the basic message of the Bible and also of the religions is we need to be considerate. We need to be polite to one another. Let's speak good and you know,
yes,
let's stop slandering and be kind to one another and lift each other,
yeah,
up.
Instead and I of think tearing down.
Yes, and I think in,
yeah,
that sense, if more both women and men were, mm, into that,
yeah,
let's be good to one another.
Yes.
Many of us would feel much more accomplished and happy,
yes,
on the inside as,
yes,
well, maybe, as on the outside.
Yes. I can just look at that as an example of you. You look like Pamela Anderson, right? Which in the Playboy, she in the Playboy world was like my biggest competitor, mm-hmm, because in this whole world, well, she's like 50 now and I'm 65 or whatever. But, you know, it was always... Now she's done another cover, then I did another cover, and then she appeared inside Playboy, and then one more. It was all Pamela Anderson, right? Now I can look at you, and you look just like Pamela Anderson. I don't see any difference, you know, pretty much the same thing. gorgeous, sexy, blonde, whatever you guys are. And I could, you know, my old me, like 30 years ago, when I was young and insecure and unfinished business of God, you know, I would look at you and I would see competition.
Yes.
I would go, oh my God, yeah. Oh my God, she's so gorgeous. Oh my God, I think I've got to go to the plastic surgeon. Mm-hmm. I got like, I don't know, I got to do something because she is so gorgeous. And then I look at myself in the mirror, I see all those little things that I didn't like, you understand mm-hmm. me? And I was always feeling less and less worthy or whatever. So then automatically that would call for competition.
Yes.
So in my own mind, I would be jealous of you and I'd maybe say something to my friend. Oh, I work with her and she was always a little plastic this or whatever, you know what I'm saying? Instead of today, I look at you and I think, gorgeous, perfect package, the best I ever saw, right? But then, instead of, oh my God, I got to go to the doctor and take away my wrinkles because Hanne doesn't have any and she's so much better looking and perfect more than me and everything, I think, what can I do for Hanne to make her even better? What can I do for you? What can I do in this program with you? This is your program. How can I serve you to make this program even better for the viewers, so you will have more viewers come in to the next programs with other performers or actors or whatever. You understand?
I understand what you mean.
I want to help you, no matter how gorgeous and perfect you are.
And I think that you're using a word to serve. And many times when you use that word and you speak to many feminists, really, and say that the woman should serve the man in the relationship or the marriage, they're all that angry. But
it goes both ways, though.
Yeah, but that's my point. But still, when you use the word serve, mm-hmm. there's something in the Western culture of today, the culture, I would say, of greed and selfishness and pushing everyone else away to push myself forward. Yeah. When you say serve or you say humility, people are like shocked because humility is something bad. Pride we like the word pride. Okay. That's also pushing other people away and meek, but to serve one another.
Yeah.
So I think we need, and there's also that combined with the lack of good self-esteem that we see in the West as well. Women are always competing, yes. You know, there's this competition and this.
Yeah.
So I think that it's if
endless.
We had some more consideration, and many other cultures have that very strongly in them, and in Muslim countries, really, the ability to serve. Yeah. So if I want to show you respect, yeah. I respect you for being you, then it's in me to try to serve you and
better.
To help you prosper and mm-hmm. help mm-hmm. you become mm-hmm. accomplished. Mm-hmm. And as I said previously, I do think that's a big secret. Also mm-hmm. for my feeling of accomplishment, there's a secret in this. If I do what's good, I'll feel good.
Right.
If I do what's bad, I will feel bad.
It's karma.
So whatever bread, like the Bible says, you throw into the water is what the same bread that's... You push out envy and you push out slander. Let's say I walk out of here and say, mm-hmm. who did she think she was? And she looks whatever, this and that. You know, I mean, I pull mm-hmm, out mm-hmm, slander, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I will get slander back. So there's something in this, and Buddhism also speaks about this, the yin and the yang. Mm-hmm, we need to, and I think we need to have a much stronger awareness in the West on this, and we mm-hmm. women need to work together and make each other strong instead of weakening each other.
Right. Yeah, I agree with you. I think that also it's easy to forget that we are in this world together, and especially today there's an awakening, there's a big positive shift in the world, but it's also terrorism, which has never been as bad as it is today. So you have the yin and the yang, you know, it's this big, big battle. But we cannot forget that no matter who we are, if we have a little bit of fame or a little bit of recognition, I think that is our responsibility to use that for the common good. I shouldn't sit here and talk about my sexy boyfriends and how good they were in bed. I've seen famous women do that, and they talk about sexuality stuff, and they're using their fame to, get more fame or make more scandal happen around their name or something. So maybe people will open their eyes and go, oh my God, really, did she say that or whatever? I think when you're famous, you should go out and you should use that to serve the common good. And we cannot forget that we're all here together like this big piece, a big, big puzzle. And you are serving, you are this little piece, and I'm this little piece. But we're all helping to make this big puzzle happen. Because if all the little pieces doesn't do their individual work, then this big puzzle will not be complete. And I think God has a huge plan, and all of us, no matter who we are, we have our little purpose in God's big plan. and we are here to help and to serve a bigger idea. You know, individually we are great, but together, everyone, we are like, and in the whole world as a big group, we could, I mean, I don't know, go to the moon. I don't know where we're going to go, all of us in this world, but with all these beautiful religions.
Bring some love.
Love can bring some more love into the world. Yes.
And I think that's...
Work together. Yeah. All the religions, all the colors, all the cultures, backgrounds, whatever. Put together in a big melting pot and work together and stop competing. Stop being jealous and putting each other down and stealing and whatever, because we're all going to end up dead, I mean, unhappy and then dead eventually if we don't come together.
And I think this can be really a wonderful ending word, actually. We should start to love one another in a whole new way than what we see
in the world
today.
It's easy to say, but we've got to walk the talk.
And on that note, I would like to thank you very much, fiery Lillian Müller. Beautiful woman. It's an honor to have you here in Scandinavia at the Herland Report.
Thank you. Appreciate it. You're great. Can I come back?
Yes, okay. You may.
Thank you.